What do the Hayward Fault, Sri Nisargadatta, Total Paradigm Shift, Blood Moon, and that leaf blower have to do with each other? They're all going to be in this video, and probably a lot more. Welcome to the video. And as usual on Wednesday, the leaf blower is tormenting us. But that's okay, because everything is tormenting us, actually. I had a paradigm shift today, the likes of which that I was even off my charts. And I just had to laugh. How I could have got this, you know, is quite something. But it didn't faze me. I'm fine. And it's just amazing, absolutely amazing. Never heard this written about, talked about. It's just like, wow. And it totally, totally, totally fits. Was reading Sri Nisargadatta's I Am That last night. And it was amazing. As the intensity builds of the leaf blower, it was amazing because he I love his clarity and his responses. I understood where he's coming from very well. And he's definitely what you would say is an enlightened being. I leave him out sometimes of the talk when you talk about Ramana Maharshi and Anandamayi. Nisargadatta has to be there too. He is certainly, the way he presents it is just very, very wonderful, actually. It's just there's too much of it in the book. 390 pages, you can overdose on it, but you get little bits of it, just like, wow, wow. He's just so clear and so direct, and it's just like wonderful, wonderful stuff. Now, the Hayward Fault Line goes along the East Bay of the San Francisco Bay Area through Hayward, through Oakland, Berkeley, that area. Had a dream last night, earthquake in the dream, definitely was able to pinpoint it in the likely area of the Hayward Fault, actually. Because I was shown a Kaiser Permanente building there. I was in a building, and I was shown a map and everything. I saw the street names and the whole thing, and everything started shaking. And I said, whoa, I feel like an earthquake. We ran out of the building, and I looked up at another building, and I could see everything's like swaying like that. And someone said, yeah, you're real close to the Kaiser Center or something, Kaiser Medical Center. So I looked up, and the Kaiser Medical Center on the Hayward Fault is being shut down because of seismic instability. And in the map I was shown like a marina kind of area with like water, ocean bay. It seemed like a bay area there, where like Alameda, the island. And so a lot of different ways I've been able to narrow it down, I believe, to the Hayward Fault, which is due to pop, because it is every about 140 years throughout history, it's popped. That's the average. And sometimes it's 140, 144, 160, 90, you know, it's pretty consistent, actually. Pretty darn consistent, with a more consistent fault. So you can basically, it's been 146 years now since it's popped. I think it was like 1868 was the last time, and it popped pretty good back then, 7.2 or something. It really, really shook. Now this one that I experienced, it didn't seem to be too bad, but it's hard to say if that was just the beginning of it or what. Could be a pretty strong one, actually. Indications that I've sort of been trying to figure it out today, and something came with an 8.3, which would be huge. It seems too large for that fault line, actually. But we're in a super active quake time now in the world. There's a lot of stuff coming. The blood moons have started the cycle off. That was April 15th. It's now the 16th. So we can expect. I also was able to corroborate an experience I had about 10 years ago, which showed me what is to come and the disaster to come. And I could never figure out the symbology exactly. And this morning it just clicked for me. 214. 214. Is the year is the year that the turnover times are going to happen, 214. And I said the blood moon is going to start that cycle. So expect the Hayward fall to pop sometime in the near future. I don't know how bad it is. I saw this thing swaying that was hanging off buildings, and so definitely there was rocking going on. And I then awoke, came out of the dream. It's hard to say. Usually, if I have a dream of a quake like that, the quake happens. I've had instances where I nailed it to the very day when the quake was going to happen. And as far as the Boxing Day Indonesian quake, it was 6 months ahead of time, and I nailed the intensity of that exactly right. But I didn't know where it was or how, where it would take place or when. And I don't know exactly when this Hayward quake is going to take place, but it is coming. The Hayward quake is going to happen. Don't know exactly how bad it will be. Could be a strong one. I don't know. But here we go. Here we go. Here we go. Now the paradigm shift is again the. It's so incredible. It's taken me a lifetime of preparation to be able to handle it. Lifetime of preparation. I can see why now, because it's so mind-boggling that you just couldn't allow yourself to accept it without just a ton of preparation, of stretching your boundaries of what's believable, stretching your boundaries of different theories, different explanations, being able to entertain different explanations for what's going on in the world, what's really taking place here. And this one, I just shaking my head. It is the most, I don't even know how to present it. I can present it, but if you're not prepared for it, you just can't go with it. You just can't go with it. But the upshot of this is, I feel very free and unconcerned about going to a place of safety at this time, and it doesn't matter what happens to the world, quite frankly. It doesn't matter at all. If we know what the world really is, then it's totally irrelevant what happens to the world. Totally irrelevant. And I feel this way now. I feel very free, like, hey, I know the troubles are coming, and it doesn't matter what happens here. It's all this. Oh my gosh, incredible joke. The only thing you can do is laugh at how ridiculous it is, actually. And just chuckle. That's the right response. That's how I responded to it. I said, okay, now I see. Now I see what's going on. But if you take this world seriously at all, you cannot understand what the situation really is, because it is just... It's a big joke. It is a big joke. But it's really difficult to get to this point. There's no question. But it's because it requires certain recognitions along the way in order to fit it together, and then just all fits like a glove. It fits like a glove, and you say, of course, of course, of course. Oh my gosh. But because of the continuity fear, people don't want to see it. They're afraid that continuity issue is going to arise. Just a minute. All right. Now, by the way, before I started this video, the video was all red. And I couldn't get, I tried to adjust, I couldn't get rid of it. And then suddenly, just before I started, it all poof, went back to white again, the normal colors here. Never happened before. Very, very interesting. The paradigm shift, it's a total paradigm shift about this world, total. And it's something that people have never even considered, for sure, never even considered. It's only recently that I've started to get this idea, like, hey, I think maybe this is it. So it would come as just this enormous surprise if it just popped up for you right now. You couldn't handle it. Could not have. You got to sort of ease into this, and hopefully these videos have been helping people ease into it. But you have to get into it at your own speed. Let's see how to present it. there's several sticking points, several difficulties. I have said that this world, this universe is, it's a projection of mind, of spirit. Spirit is, wants to create, wants to be prime creator, wants to be a new prime creator. It says, I want to be like God. I want to be the one who creates creation. I want to be the creator, prime creator. So the spirit has to create differently than God, because if it's just creating the same, it's just extending God's creation. So it's not prime creator, it's extending it. So this is the central to understanding what the world is. What we're trying to create a creation that doesn't recognize its creator. It doesn't recognize its creator. Because the God's creation is that all of God's creation recognizes God as the creator. So we say, no, I don't want that. We want a creation that's totally different, where our creations don't recognize the creator. Okay, this is central to understanding the situation we're in. So we have tried to do this. We're trying to make a creation that doesn't recognize its creator. This is what the world and all this is all about, actually. That's what it's all about. And it certainly, if you try to follow it intellectually, you're going to stumble and fall. You have to somehow intuitively recognize this through a lot of efforts and clarification. And you just say, yeah, of course, it all fits together. But if you try to do it piece by piece, the wheels are going to come off. But that's the first premise. Okay, now, we'll look at it from a different angle. This world, there's another premise we have. Basically, what we're saying is this world of time and space is actually a projection. This world, all of this is a projection. It's not a creation, it's a projection. And it's like a gestation, like a pregnancy. We say, well, this is a becoming. It's a gestation where everything, this period is necessary before the birth of our creation that we want, which totally is separate from us and doesn't recognize us at all as its creator. That's what we're aiming for. So we're aiming for a creation that has no recognition of its creator whatsoever, no knowledge of it, recognition, nothing. So what we're doing is we are providing a history for the creation to be, which we believe will, and all of this history, the history of the universe, is actually a history that we have been making, manufacturing, so that when this so-called new creation is created, it will believe that it came as a result of the process of all of the history of the universe, billions of years, and matter and energy and all this stuff interacting. It will believe that that's where it came from, instead of it came from us, spirit, as a projection of spirit. So in order to think, to convince our new creation that it didn't come from us, we are simply manufacturing a history for it. This universe, this world, these bodies, everything happening is simply, we are manufacturing a past for what we believe to be a new creation. That is the facts of the situation. And if you can just sort of intuitively get a flash on that, you can't help but just chuckle. Always, oh my gosh. Holy cow. That's my reaction. Yeah, I said, yeah, of course, that's it. Now, here's the next part. We believe that once this history of where this new creation came from has been properly staged and has a sufficient time to it and complexity and all this, that will trigger the birth of this new creation. It will automatically trigger this birth. So we have this magical belief that the reason why this new creation hasn't been created yet is because we haven't produced enough time and circumstance in time and space yet to trigger its birth. But once we do, that'll automatically trigger its birth. So that's why we keep on keeping on with time. We say, well, we need to make a little more time, and then we're almost there. And so we keep thinking that if we just do a little more intensity, more time, more death, more suffering, all the stuff that's completely different than reality. See, we want this reminder, this history for our new creation, to not remind our new creation about reality in the slightest bit, where we are actually. So that we won't have the faintest idea that such a place exists at all. So we have fashioned this world to be utterly different, this universe utterly different than reality, totally different. Fragments, time, space, fragments, death, impermanence, all of this stuff. See, we think our new creation is born into this, and it says, this is your womb, this is where you came from, this is your mother. And they'll say, oh, okay. And won't have the foggiest notion of what really created it, which is actually would be us. That's why we have death. That's why we have suffering. We have impermanence, sickness, suffering, conflict, everything. We've fashioned all of that intentionally to give a false picture of where this new creation would be coming from. The kicker of it all, of course, is there is no new creation at all. This is all we've done is this is completely useless. This past that we fashion is utterly without any application whatsoever. That's the joke of it all, you know. Like, oh my gosh, there is no pregnancy, there is no gestation, there is no child, there is no birth, there is no new creation that we are at all. But we say there is, it just hasn't been triggered yet because we don't have enough history. The background story isn't sufficiently convincing yet. So we keep conning ourselves, saying, it's coming, it's coming, it's coming. And when we see this, then that helps us out measurably. We just say, oh my gosh, much ado about nothing. All of this past that we're manufacturing has no application at all. Might as well give it a different purpose, right? The purpose that we've given it is to convince this so-called new, this new child that we're creating separate from God, that this is its mother. This is what created it. Time and space and all this death, impermanence and suffering and chaos and misery and all of this building up, breaking down, reproduction, everything, thinking it comes from this. All of that has no use at all. There is no child to be born at all. So what do we do with it? What do we do with this entire history and all our future plans, right, for this? What do we do with it? Do we just say, have it vanish? Yeah, it was just a play of our imagination, trying to concoct a false background. Or we say, okay, we're so used to this, we're too scared to drop it all. Let's give it a different purpose. Let's use it to remind us of non-projection, remind us of reality. And that's what the Holy Spirit does. It will bless everything. All this whole story, this past we've conjured up to try to convince a so-called new creation that this is its history, this is its creator, time and space and all the dynamics of that. That's useless, so we'll use that to remind us of reality, which is to see everything as equally blessed vertically in the one relationship with omnipresence. Everything has this vertical relationship with omnipresence. And the horizontal stuff is just useless. It's like a shadow now. It's just like a shadow because there's no use for it. So all the death, the impermanence, all that kind of stuff, that has no relevance to anything anymore. What has the relevance is that everything as it is right now totally dwelling in omnipresence. And that reminds us of reality, of non-projection. This is how the whole situation is resolved. So there you go, that's a pretty good little nutshell explanation of this paradigm shift. And it's like, wow, look at all the effort we went to try and convince what we believe would be our new creation that it didn't come from us. That's exactly what we've done. We've gone to all this elaborate ruse to convince what we believe would be our new creation as soon as this ruse was perfected, that it didn't come from us, it came from this mother of time and space, the great mother of time and space. What an elaborate ruse. And the kicker is there is no child. no child at all. Nothing's going to be born. No eternal life. Eternal life. It's all waste of time. Total waste of time. And we spent this elaborate, fashioning elaborate ruse, and the joke is on us. We just pranked ourselves. Just pranked ourselves. And when we see it, we can't help but have a chuckle over it, really. It's just so, oh my gosh, yeah. And this is not a explanation that I've ever heard. I've never heard this type of explanation in any reading, spiritual reading whatsoever. But for me, it absolutely fits with everything the Holy Spirit has revealed to me. What the gurus talk about is this vertical relationship with the Absolute, that everything is the Absolute. It is. Which, of course, invalidates our whole ruse by telling, we think our new creation has to believe it came from this linear time of all these relationships, separate relationships taking place, and now there's so much separate relationship, eventually all be able to look at is all these separate relationships and say, oh, I came from all of that. I'm a child of all these changing, fluctuating, rising, dying relationships like that, and that's what relationship is. But the thing is that no, all of this, there's only one relationship and everything is it. There's only one relationship and everything is it. That's what like Sri Nisargadatta is talking about. There's just this one relationship. Everything is it. All the horizontal dance of time and space doesn't mean anything. Doesn't mean anything. It's a ruse. To trick a child that's never going to be born. It's like setting up a nursery for a child, and you set it up in such a way as to convince the child that you know, this is it. Yeah, somehow we're trying to convince it this is what gave birth, the nursery gave birth to it. Like the parents don't want to be recognized. They want to convince the child that it came, the nursery gave birth to it, something like that, you know? So the nursery is space and time and all appearances, and activity in space and time, and we believe that that will convince our creation that that's where it came from. So it'll believe it's separate from us, and won't recognize us, and therefore we can say that we're prime creators because we created this new type of eternal life, new life. Because if we created exactly the same as God creates, we would know that where do we get this? It would be a completely obvious. It's an extension of what God gave us. Right? So we have to create an entirely opposite way that bears no resemblance to what God... That's the only other way we could create, is try to create stuff that's separate from us. Separate creations. So all of this fits together if you're able to accept it. And once we realize this, of course, then the horizontal dance of time and space, what happens in there is absolutely meaningless. It doesn't matter in the slightest bit. It's all a ruse. Entirely a ruse. And so it's easy to just step back from it. You see, what we're trying to do is make time and space and everything that happens in it be totally unlike reality. So our creation has not even any inkling of reality whatsoever. So of course we have these conflicts and these belligerencies and anger and hostility and all that. That's all by design, actually. It's by design. But we don't necessarily have to. We don't have to... indulge and engage in that. Once we realize there's no need for any of this, we can accept the blessing upon everything. Everything is blessed by holiness. When everything is blessed by holiness, then there can be this type of peace, but the inner peace, no matter, you know, and a lessening of all of this intense stuff. Because we're not trying to use our projections to convince anymore, or to mislead anymore. It's a game changer. It is a game changer. So we don't have to pay attention to what happens here in the world, all the sufferings, the misery to come, and all the stuff that's coming. It's no use to it anymore for us. It serves no purpose at all. No purpose. And so for me, I felt like very liberated by seeing this. And then I said, you know what? I don't need to stick around here and see all this stuff that goes wrong here. I see what the purpose of it is to try and paint a portrait of a place utterly different than reality, so that our so-called new creation will be completely fooled and deceived, thinking that this is where it comes from, and will never have any inkling of where it really came from. This is... Oh, something just slipped down there and let the light in. How about that? Okay. One minute. All right, which is fine, but as far as the lighting goes here, there's just symbolic that the curtain has come down and the light has shone in. And yeah. So... There's something about the way that Sri Nisargadatta answered the questions there that I liked. I said, wow, that's really cool the way he did it. I like this teacher, really. And actually, a lot of non-dualism comes from Sri Nisargadatta, a lot. The whole Sailor Bob lineage comes from that. A lot of the non-dual teachers really come from Sri Nisargadatta, that lineage. Or a lot of their teachers come from the Ramana Punjaji lineage. Those are like two of the most, you know, big time lineages. I don't come from those lineages myself directly at all. I seem to be like a maverick that is sort of pioneering this new paradigm shift, which I feel is by far and away the best way to look at it, because it brings humor into the whole thing. It just like it lightens everything up. It takes all the heaviness out of it, and all the questions just dissolve. Once you see it this way, you know, what questions do you have? You know, it's just like, just wow, it's just closure. You just say, oh wow, my gosh, yeah, isn't that funny? Isn't that funny? I've just been making all, doing all this for nothing. And we have all these humans running around, okay, who don't have any idea what made them or who made them, why they're here. You know, they think this is, I was made from time and space, and the God, my God is a time and space God, made all this, I came from there, whatever. And so it's kind of like we want to make our true, you know, new creation feel, look at all this, and say, oh yeah, look at all these creatures, these human beings, and that's what they believe, and, you know, just, yeah. Okay, this is the history that I came from. Everyone always believed in this and always suffered like this, and you know, and so we're just part of the staging of the past. Actually, all human life is just part of building this historical record of evidence. That's all it is, and it's all evidence for nothing. You see, see how that frees you up from your life, from your human incarnations, from all this nonsense of a need to even appear in this ridiculous play of fragmentation and impermanence, is because it's completely useless. So, when the great mother goddess tells you, hey, we need to build a little more historical record here because the creation hasn't happened yet, which is all she can ever say because it never will happen, you can just have a good laugh at that. You know, it is a false pregnancy. There's no child there. It's all completely useless, absolutely useless. And you'll say, well, why don't you help out anyway? And no. We'll listen to the Holy Spirit as far as how we help out here. Because helping out is really to lead people to recognize this in good humor. In good humor. Really, the spiritual path should be in good humor. It really should. And it's funny, the words of Sri Nisargadatta, I find them very humorous. I find him have a great sense of humor. and very the way he answers is wonderful. I really like that. But people used to say he's so intense, he's intimidating. No. I don't see that at all. He seems to be have very good humor about the situation, and I get a kick out of it. I have laughter there. So we're really being led to this laughter. We have to laugh at what we've done. We have to laugh at just how utterly absurd the entire thing has been. Totally absurd. Now, I always knew that God had absolutely nothing to do with all of this. Nothing to do with it. But I couldn't quite understand, well, what is it then? You know, what's going on here? My question was, what's going on here? And I know God, Jesus told us God did not create death, did not create impermanence. All life is eternal life. Whatever dies was never alive in the first place. I said, yes. Of course, when I read A Course in Miracles, I said, yes, this is very true what's being said. And yet, it was not said, what I'm saying here was not brought to light in that particular book teaching. But it pointed to it. So I knew this is not what God is doing. What's doing this? Why is all this here anyway? It doesn't add up at all. Nothing adds up. But when you put in this explanation that I got this morning, everything adds up. It's the whole thing is just poof, done. And it's an amazing thing that this really began to coalesce on the 15th of April. And on the 16th, morning of the 16th of April, poof, then I was able to, the whole thing popped, I was able to see it. Just the timing is perfect, because I said around this blood moon, April 15th is the date, got to be very much ready by then, by the 5th. And it appears I was ready. And so now as the cycle now starts, as the 15th is over, the 16th, starting the cycle now, the realization was there. So the timing of the Holy Spirit was absolutely fantastic. Fantastic. Where now I feel very free to take refuge and it not bother me in the slightest bit. In very good humor, actually. And the real teachers are the ones that, you know, have this great good humor to them. And so people say, well, what's the joke? Let me in on the joke. Yeah. And they're interested. I said, they know, you know, I know something isn't right here. I feel like maybe it's like a big joke. It's like a cosmic joke is going on. It is. It's a cosmic joke that's going on. We're joking ourselves. We're playing a joke on ourselves. We've done all this nursery. We've built this total past. We've built all this past of all these planets and suns and stars and formation and forms of activity and impermanence, all these appearances, all this nursery, this vast nursery of time and space. We've done all of that, all for nothing. All for nothing. That's, you know, you can either feel crushed by it, or you can say, that's pretty doggone funny. And that's the humor. It's like, oh my gosh, yeah. And all this big pregnancy we think is gestation, is, you know, here it comes, it's almost here, there's nothing there, there's never been anything there. I think what someone said, some non-dualist said, nothing's ever happened. Another way to say it, nothing's ever been there. There's never been anything there in the womb of time and space. No child's ever been there. So it depends how you take it. If you're prepared, you will feel very liberating. And you say, oh my gosh, this is fantastic. This is fantastic. You see it. Oh my gosh, I don't even have to engage with this stuff anymore. I'm done with it. There's no reason to engage with it anymore. And there's no harm at all. You see? Nothing's been harm. We're building this up to give a false picture to what we hope to be our new creation. Since there is no new creation, it won't get a false picture. And since this false picture was for the new creation, and there isn't any, there's really no purpose for it anymore at all. It doesn't hurt reality, hasn't hurt reality. It's just, there's just nothing. No harm, no foul, nothing's ever happened. Nothing ever will happen. So we just set it down. We just set it down. Set the whole thing down. And that's, you know, that's the great good news. That's the gospel. So I told the Holy Spirit, you had to deliver the gospel at this time. You know, around April 5th, the first blood moon of the tetrad cycle. And this time frame was essential. So I was all over it, just working like crazy till this time. And then the fruit of that, you know, the labor was over by the 15th. It was. I did it. I realized I did it. I didn't know what was going to arise, what the fruit would drop from the tree would be. And then the sixth morning, the 16th, the fruit dropped from the tree. And I ate of it. And I said, wow, that's great. That is good fruit. It is great fruit. It is great good news. That's the gospel. This is really a gospel, a wonderful gospel. Holy cow. Because if we think that the child's going to be born, oh my gosh, this child, we're going to be giving a completely deceptive picture to this creation. How awful would that be? You know, how crazy, how terrible we'd feel, how much guilt we would feel, right? We have all this guilt we're feeling. Why? Because we know we're lying to our, we're going to be lying to our new creation, completely lying and telling it came from death and impermanence and misery and suffering, all this kind of stuff. That's horrible, horrible. But the great good news is there isn't going to be any new creation at all from this. And so where's the guilt then? There's no more guilt. We're not going to cause a problem to anything. That's it. So, poof, the guilt gone, evaporated. We don't really have guilt about bodies and people because those are just state imaginings to build up this historical record that we're doing. The guilt is actually over towards belief that this new creation that we're going to create is going to be completely lied to and deceived. You know, we feel awful about that. We feel awful. But what a relief to find out there isn't ever going to be such a birth. So the deception will never reach its target. It'll never have any effect at all. It's useless. All the deception of this universe is totally useless. Will never cause any harm. Never. And so, you can see how that will lift the guilt off of us, right? Oh, hallelujah. We say we're free of our sin. We're free of our sin. Now, the whole Jesus thing is a very interesting story. It's in some ways starting to fit like, you know, okay, we thought Jesus is this new creation that's being born of the world, and the world killed him, and then somehow Jesus was resurrected. It's kind of like he said, you know what? I didn't fall for your trick. And so that lifts the burden of sin off of us. It's like Spirit saying, okay, you know, here's the new birth, and the new birth's going to say, no, I recognize my true creator, or something. There's something about it like that, but it's, you know, how it's all figured and understood, I don't know. And I'm not going to try and struggle with it too much, but it's possible that this has something to do with the entire situation, is that this was some way of lifting the burden of guilt and sin off of everyone by saying, you know what, you didn't fool me, you know. But it's not really a new creation at all, you know, but you just, you know, there's something about that. So we'll just let that be as it is. If people can get to it that way, fine, if they can. But here, we can get to it directly, very directly. Very directly, by just seeing it. Just seeing it through reason. Reason tells us. We don't need all this blood and death and drama and stuff. Just easy, clear reason. Just see it, say, wow. Of course, projections are not creation because they're not God-created creation, all right? Our ability to create comes from God, not from us. And our ability to create only creates eternally. It's an extension. It's not a reproduction. It's an extension where we are still there in the extension entirely. And so our extensions know us directly, all the way back to the prime creator. It's a totality of knowing. It is not this crazy reproduction that we're going on here in the universe. Begetting and begatting and reproducing. And this is a picture of something completely alien to reality, as we wanted to produce a picture that totally alien to reality, so our creation would have no idea where it really came from. The projections are not creation. We're trying to project something separate from us. That's what projection is all about. Extension. Okay. So really, the quality of a teacher should be overflowing with bliss and laughter. Even though it's not being expressed, there's this feeling of I may not be laughing all the time, but there's a feeling of non-constriction, of lightness, of unconcern, of lack of guilt, and ability to just laugh at the entire situation is quite funny. The whole thing is a freedom from it. It's a sense of freedom. Oh my gosh. We were just concocting a past, a false past, to convince what we thought we were going to create that we weren't its creator. And us, by extension, God, is not his creator, really. It came from, you know, and then we think then that's a new creation. The creation doesn't recognize its creator as a new creation, you see. And then he'll say, you see, we're the new prime creator. We've come up with a new creation, what creation that doesn't recognize its creator. It's like, oh my gosh, that's why the world is so crazy. You see, that's why it's crazy by design. It's all crazy. And so when people ask all these questions, you know, Why is the world this way? You know, why? How come? It's just simple answers. It's crazy by design. We have a false picture. So it doesn't remind, it won't remind, be reminiscent of reality. It will give no reminiscence of reality, no remembrance of reality whatsoever. It's crazy by design. And projection must be this way. Because our desire is such, it has to give rise to. It can't give rise to eternal life, because that would theoretically remind any creation of where it came from, eternal life, coming from eternal life. So it has to be non-eternal life, which is nothing, which is what? Death. And what dies is not alive in the first place, just imagination. So this whole thing is just in the mind of imagination. It's just imagination. We're just imagining it all. And of course, we've added in, all this comes from God. It all comes from God. And so this new creation will say, oh, you come from this God of impermanence and death and everything. Sure, you created all this stuff. So it doesn't know that we did it, you see. So of course, we also project a God into this projection, saying that this is where it came from. You know, I mean, but for me, I was like, I never accepted that. I said, there's no way in the world that the true creator could possibly create impermanence and death and this all this nonsense, fear and conflict. Impossible. Totally impossible. So I never bought into that. And yet, then the problem remained, well, where does it come from? What is its purpose? The non-dualists and Bidens, the thing is, they just say, well, we don't know. And they just skip it. They didn't even look at that. They just say, for some reason, I don't know, it's just here, I don't know. We don't know why, some strange reason, but the question is, who's asking the question is what they'll always say. So they just skip over that part. But for me, I didn't skip over that part. For me, that's central. But they have their own approach, which works, has historically worked. So I cannot say it doesn't work. But I would say this approach here is a wonderful approach. The guru system of the East is built on trusting and faith in the guru. So in other words, Srinivasagadatta said that he just believed what his guru told him. And it just says, let everything, you know, die down, you'll be quiet. And the advice he gave him, he just accepted it and trusted it without question, and just applied it. So, you know, that is a way, if you can have that trust, for sure. For sure, because it's a shortcut. What his guru gave him is a shortcut, and shortcuts are possible. For instance, we simply say, I have no choice but to recognize the situation, because we don't. There isn't ever going to be any birth, so there's nothing to look forward to. So there's no other option but to realize the vertical, that everything is already totally one with the one relationship. We don't have a choice in the matter. We don't have any other option whatsoever. So we don't have a choice. Choice between two options. We don't have two options. We have one. So one of the shortcuts you can use is, I don't have any choice. Why am I waking up? Because I don't have any choice, which is entirely true. The option to delay is a different type of choice. It just means, when am I willing to accept that I don't have a choice, that I don't have options? When am I willing to accept I don't have options? That's different than saying, well, I have options, I'm just going to choose the right one. We don't have options. There's only one relationship. There's only one prime creator. There's only one reality. There's only one creation, way to create. There is no other option. We don't have a choice. I don't have a choice. This is a shortcut. Some of the gurus are very good at giving shortcuts, but it's entirely based, as Srinivasagadatta says, on trusting in the guru. If you don't trust in the guru, then you have to take another way, another path. What is this thing doing? Hold on. Okay. So, here in the West, we don't have that quite that type of trust. Now, maybe Jesus is a shortcut and people trusted him. I haven't seen much fruit of that to give evidence of it, but some say that there's a lot of fruit, so we'll let them say what they say. A Course in Miracles is certainly lays the foundation for shortcuts, but the shortcuts are a result of a strong foundation built up through a long time. And so when you get someone like Srinivasagadatta going to his guru, and his guru just said, just do this, and very soon you will realize the truth. He just said, okay, and just did it, and boom, within a matter of what, several years, he was awake. And they said, how did you do that? And he said, I just absolutely trusted my teacher that what he told me to do would work, and I just did it, without even questioning, I just did it. So this is very amazing, actually. But it's the result of the guru system that they have, of implicit faith in the guru like that, that they would do that. So theoretically, that can work. Yes, it can, because he just took a shortcut, is what he did. I understand this, that a lot of this non-dual teaching is actually our shortcuts. Okay, but that requires implicit faith in the guru, implicit faith. If you don't have it, it's not going to work. It's not going to work. And he said that. Sargana said that. If you don't have this faith and trust, it won't work for you. He's a very, very honest guy. Very straightforward and extremely honest. And very clear. I just love the sincerity and earnestness and clarity there. It's just, you know, wow. He said, it won't work if you don't have the faith. And it's true. So you have to realize, if you don't have that, what do you do? Well, there is another way, which is the way I took, which is to listen to the voice of reason within, and the Holy Spirit will clarify the whole situation for you. And the clarification may be way wider than the non-dual clarification, because the whole point of the non-dual path is to take the shortcut and save time, so you don't even worry about any of that other stuff. You just go, you know, direct. you realize the one relationship just directly like that, and you leave out all that other stuff, and that's fine. But from my perspective, I have a wider perspective in terms of seeing, you know, what the purpose of all this. You know, I'm not just brushing it aside and say, wow, it's just a big mystery, I don't know, you know, whatever. See, their path, that interferes with the shortcut, so they don't entertain it. It's not that they don't know, probably, it's that it simply interferes with the shortcut, which is to say, I have no choice. That's a shortcut. So I have no choice. I have no choice. I have no choice. If you say that over and over and over and accept it, that is a super shortcut, actually. There are many other shortcuts that can be used. But these are based on very mature practitioners, based on the entire faith in the guru system, that they're giving you, what they're giving you works, really is going to work for you without any question. As soon as you start questioning it, the shortcut is no longer there. And then it takes too long, and then you start doubting it even more. See, he got it in a matter of a few years, so he said, yeah, see, it did work. I was just, my faith was justified. Then he was correct in that. Similar with Punjaji going to Sri Ramana Maharshi. Ramana Maharshi, he went there, and in a short period of time, he got it. He got it. You know, who's seeing? Who's the seer? Who's the seer? Who's the seer? That kind of thing. That's a shortcut. But if you don't have the faith in the teacher, then it's not going to work. It's not going to work. So, but I'm looking at the situation. I say, well, what do we do now? Because there's so little faith. And the problem of the world now is there's very little faith in teachers. The ego's done a remarkable job in undermining all of that. And why is it? What is the ego doing? It's our own attempt to, again, concoct this fake past. And so we don't want to have any truth anywhere in this fake past. So our so-called our new creation will be entirely convinced that there is no such thing as reality, that this is reality. This is what gave birth to it. So if you have all these teachers and saviors and etc. in the historical record and people are being enlightened, it ruins the effect. So there's this enormous attempt to undermine and discredit all true spiritual realization and teaching and all of that at this time. And to emphasize the false teachings, therefore you have a lack of faith in this world right now, a lack of the genuine, for sure, you know, the teacher, what they say, just do it, and you're going to, it's a shortcut, you're going to save yourself a massive amount of time. That's why you're not getting the great awakenings at this time. So Jesus understood that, gave A Course in Miracles, which enables us to build this very stable foundation of under within us. So the guru is not even needed, but it takes us longer. That is true. That is true. Yeah, there's no question. If you really had trust in a teacher, complete trust and faith, and they told you to just do this, you could do it in a matter of years. That is true. If you just said, I have no choice. I have absolutely no choice. There is no choice. I have no choice. There's no choice to be made. That can evaporate the whole thing very quickly. But who's going to do that? There's nobody going to do that. I don't know. It'd be super rare for anybody to do that, actually. But theoretically, it's possible. I mean, I started doing that yesterday, and look what happened. Boom. And almost instant enlightenment. It's just going right to it. I'm not enlightened yet, but I'm aware of the parameters of the basis of it. I'm very much aware of the basis of it now. And that was just a matter of doing it for a day or something. I have no choice. I have no choice. I have no choice. So potent shortcut. Maybe some people can use that. I don't know. I hope so. I mean, saving time is the greatest thing ever. How many others got it from Sri Nisargadatta's guru? I don't know. There's probably some others that were awakened too. He's, the best known to the West of those who did get it. So, you know, we've lavished all this attention and care on this false past. So we're kind of attached to it. We see the breeze rustle the leaves, and, you know, it's just like, oh, we've been working on this for so long, but really we don't like it at all. Honestly, we say, oh God, it's so terrible. Can we not be free of this? We're just waiting for the birth of the child, and once the child is born, we're done with it, you know. Okay, here's your ball game now. We've done, but the child's never going to be born. So we're continually enslaved to working on it even more, you know, producing all these bodies, identifying with them, have them go through their lives just, you know, like these comatose morons, and just providing more bones for this false past story. And we're so tired of it. But we see a little bit of flicker here and there, something that's kind of, you know, there's nice glossy leaves there, and the sunlight's coming off the leaves. And, you know, there's some flowers there, but they're wilting, and they'll soon be dead. And it's like, oh God, there's nothing like reality. So we're so tired of this. We're so tired. And of course, the birth, we're trying to induce labor now. We think we've finally done enough. Okay, let's induce labor, or let's just put the finishing icing on the cake and make it such a horrible place that it becomes so convincing that this premise we have, that when this false path becomes utterly convincing, that'll automatically trigger the birth of the child. So we think we're triggering the birth of the child by going through all this, you know, stuff, you know. Can you imagine our true God creating a world where it's all subject to earthquakes, constant earthquakes all over the place, tsunamis? Oh, we live in fear. I mean, California, we live in dread of earthquakes, but in the Bay Area, Los Angeles especially, we know the big one's coming. You know, it's just our whole lives in the background. It's like, oh my gosh, at some point, all this is just going to, we're just going to be, the infrastructure is just going to be wrecked. You know, the whole thing is just going to be an absolute nightmare. Now, we've done a lot of seismic refits and stuff like that, but still, the whole feeling of living on an earthquake fault, I'm telling you, it is the worst thing. Well, the worst thing is actually growing up during the Cold War, thinking that every day you're likely to hear the air raid sirens and they're going to be nuclear bombs dropping on you, and you're going to be instantly vaporized. That's how I grew up here on the West Coast. Prime target right here. And now here comes the Cold War again, you know, with Russia and their, what is that, the head of the new news agency or something, new news channel, saying that, you know, Russia is the only country in the world that can reduce USA to ashes, meaning nuclear weapons. And then basically saying the Cold War's back on, you know, that just brings back all these terrible memories for me of living my whole life under the threat of being nuclear annihilation. Cold War was just absolutely terrifying for us here, for me. I really felt it so terrible, and all the atomic tests in the world. Just the idea that there's this destructive power on the planet of atomic weapons is just, for me, it's just like a complete nightmare. Do you really think that our loving, perfect, immaculate creator created worlds where there's this nuclear weapons that can be dropped by belligerent parties and incinerate each other, and earthquakes and tsunamis and pole shifts and axis tilts and all this kind of stuff? Is that it really? Really? No possibility of that whatsoever. So we are the ones who are imagining all this stuff as a means to con what we think is our new child into having no awareness of what reality is really like, so they'll never even think about, I came from some other place. This is my real creator. I must be created from somewhere else. This is my new, you know, this is where I was created from. See, that's why we're doing it. That's why we're doing all this chaos and nonsense here. Just utter nonsense. Utter nonsense. There's not even the tiniest threat of vulnerability in reality. Not even the tiniest threat. Whereas here, everything is vulnerable. And I felt that so acutely under the shadow of this dread of you know, nuclear attack. And we just, you know, just constricted and tightened up, and it just caused this deep underlying terror, tension, my whole life. Just the most horrible thing. And then add that to that, the earthquakes. It's just, you know, and the wildfires. But the earthquakes are the worst in California, because, you know, you don't know when they're coming. Except usually I'm warned about when they're coming through dreams. But that doesn't make it any better. You still think you're very jittery, because it just, it's a horrible thing. You feel so helpless. It's just, the whole earth is just moving, and you just, it's like, oh my God, I don't live in stable ground really at all. This is just terrible. So some people, it doesn't seem to bother me. It bothers me a lot. I hate earthquakes. I hate living in the Bay Area. I hate living in any earthquake area. This whole world, though, is just nothing but vulnerability, right? The whole world is nothing but that. So we've done a heck of a job in painting this false picture. Heck of a job. Made this nursery so gruesome, so terrible, so awful. We think that our creation will look at this and say, say, wow, this is where I came from. And never suspect where it really came from. Never suspect, you see. That's what we're aiming for. And we've done a heck of a job. Heck of a job. Got the Ebola financial collapse, fears of war, fears of doom of every type, all of it possible, all of it plausible, all of it potential. The potential for catastrophe here is never ending, never ending. Every time you get in a vehicle, potential for catastrophe is there. Every time you take a breath, take a step actually, it's all there, all there. Our friends, our loved ones, relatives, family, etc. Any day that they could die, you know. The potential of loss is constant, constant, constant here. Again, all a complete ruse, a complete charade. The maker, the projector of all this is immortal, is true spirit, is what we are, is the absolute. It is not affected by time and space, what it's imagining at all. It's just making this comic book, you know, this ridiculous comic book of history, so that our its offspring, supposed offspring, can spend all its time reading this comic book and saying, oh my gosh, this is where I came from. So, wow, look at all this. Yeah. This was my gestation period. This is what I went through in order to be what I am. This is where I came from. We're just making this comic book of history. And there's no need for it, because there isn't anyone who's ever going to read it. Let's see if anything else comes up. Just a second. Now, I give these videos a lot of time for a reason. Several reasons. One is only through dedicating, being used to absorbing little mini paradigm shifts in your life, do you get to the big one like this. And you have to spend a lot of time at it. And you have to absorb the impact of these little mini shifts when and you realize, oh my gosh, it's not what I thought it was. Yeah. Oh. So, you know, in order to get to the big paradigm shift, you have to practice a lot of absorbing this. I say the mood of repentance, spending quiet time like two hours or hour, 2-3 hours, whatever, of just seeing things differently, realizing it's shift, 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 like turning a big ocean liner around, you know, like that. It's very important. And also, the paradigm shift here is so enormous, so profound, that you need time just to like absorb it. You say, oh my gosh, you know, it takes hours and hours and hours to actually absorb it, and maybe days and weeks. But for me, it's I'm soaking it in pretty quickly. But it takes, now it's not like just saying that the guru, non-dual guru, saying just look within. You know, yeah, who's asking the question? Okay, great, bless you. And okay, next, what's the next question? No, this is different, because this is a direct explanation of what's going on. And if you see it, what's being said here, intuitively, you know, it's like, oh my gosh. It's like that. When I saw it this morning, I just said, oh my God. Holy cow. Yeah. And I said, I like this. This is great. You know, wow. And that means this and this. Oh my gosh. And this, oh yeah, oh. And then the insights just start pouring off of it, right? And you can't even follow them all. Don't even worry about following them all. You just remain centered and poised, and don't try to chase anything down to write a book about it. Okay, don't. Stay centered in the laughter, the good humor, and how pleased you are to see this. That's where you stay centered. Stay centered in that. The insight, everything will smooth out automatically from it. Don't go chasing after anything to write a book about it. Say, wow, I have so many insights, I could write a whole book. No, don't do that. So that's why also I'm just trying to keep you centered in the basics here. So you allow all this peripheral stuff to roll out. And you just say, okay, it doesn't really matter. Just let everything just smooth out. Let everything smooth out here. It'll smooth out on its own. And so these videos are longer to give you the opportunity to just let that kind of keep going, instead of seizing upon it and say, okay, wait a minute, I better write a book on this. I better investigate. Let me see all the different insights I can get out of this. No, stay away from that. Stay away from that. Stay on the central theme. that? How do you feel about it? I just like, that's so cool. This is so totally cool. It's great. It's all for nothing. No guilt. Let your mind stay quiet. Now, if an insight arises, I'm sure it will, just notice it and say, okay. Don't grab it. Don't hold on to it. Say, okay. See that, all right? So that's great. Great, good that I see that, all right? That's resolved, good. Riding a wave all the way to shore. Just ride the wave. So, for instance, my next wave is the fact of posting this on the for the world to listen to. That's my challenge. That's a different challenge. One is to get it for yourself and accept it for yourself. The next one is like, wow, you know, explaining it, sharing it, getting it out there available for the entire world, everybody on the planet. Actually, is it freely available? See, that is another wow. You know, really putting your neck out there, kind of thing. And you know, I don't advise people to do that. Really, I've been trained to do that. That's a whole, you know, another kind of stress, actually. It can be turned to a positive, but if you're not really proficient at that, forget about it. Forget it. I've been taping since oh gosh. 1996, 1995, 1996, 1997, in there somewhere. I started taping every day and kept that up on and off since 1996, and maybe for the last 4 or 5 years, maybe taping every single day. So thousands and thousands and thousands of tapings, really, thousands. Actually, on here there's some. I've done a lot more of it. Like I must have like, you know, over 500 or 800 that I took. I used to have on the internet. I took them down because there's no response. I just took them down, and the audio got messed up, or some of the video audio got out of sync because I didn't download them properly. Stupid, but it's okay. It's all right. Get used to that. That all's well that ends well. So I'm super used to doing this, super used to it. So if you're not super used to doing it, I would not advise trying to do it in no way. You're going to get too much backlash on this because you say, oh my God, how do I defend this? How do I defend this? How do I defend this? You know, and I'm not, you know, I've been able to process all that stress for over so many years with this. So my nerves are able to hold up to a certain extent, but it's been like a very difficult thing to do because you know 99.999% of the world absolutely disagrees with you, at least superficially, or is completely either completely indifferent or extreme disagrees to a strong extent, and the rest of us, the rest don't quite understand it all, and there's a few in the world, a few who intuitively get it, rings their bell, and they say, hey, let me look at this, you know, let me look. There's a few here and there, not a lot actually, but, who knows what the overall effect is, right? Who knows, putting the pressure on the world, putting the pressure on. As Ramana Maharshi told me, don't worry, later on, this is going to be very helpful. Don't give up. It's going to be very, he says, I see it. I already see what's going to happen. He says, very helpful. He said, just don't quit. Just keep working on it. Eventually, you'll see. So I trusted him. You know, when he told me, there's an example of trusting in the guru. I trusted when he said that, because I could tell he's completely sincere, honest person, honest, clear, honest, sincere. I could feel it. So I said, you know what? I'm going to trust that. I'm going to trust in it. Keep doing it. I'll keep trying. And I'm still doing that. And so who knows what eventually will come of it. But it's got to be super helpful, you know, in the long run. To look at it this way, you know, to be able to see it like this and just say, ah. Who would ever think liberation comes this way? You see, we're not looking in this direction at all. Not at all. Which is why we just keep struggling. Someone asked Srina Sargadatta, you know, what about this universe, the purpose, and all this kind of stuff? And they're supposed to figure out that, you know, God has this plan and purpose and all. And he said, look, you know, if a few boys decide to put on a play or something, you know, it's probably street people. They said, let's put on a little play. A few boys decide to put on a play. What do we need to notice or remember about it? Do we really need to notice or remember anything about it? He likened the universe to a few boys putting on a play. And nothing to notice or remember about it at all. You know, just like, yeah, wow. That's very true. Yeah, he doesn't care. He says, it doesn't care what happens here. This is true. It's like a few boys putting on a play. we're just putting on a play is all we're doing. For nobody. For nothing. It's not for us. You see, this universe is not for us. This is what we got to realize for spirit. It is not for us. It has nothing to do with us. It's for our child. The child we imagine we're going to be able to create separate from God, which we cannot do. There will never be that child. But that's what it's for. It's not for us. That's why we feel like this world's alien to us, right? We feel like, I don't really belong here. That's how I've always felt. I really don't belong here. This is not really what I want at all for me. So, but I feel like there's some purpose for it. I gotta go along with this, right? Definitely, though, this is definitely not my home. You know, we have this feeling like this is definitely not my home. Totally true, it's not our home. So who are we doing it for? For our child. For our child. That's why we're doing it. And there is no child born of projection. There isn't any. So we're really doing it for no one. Certainly not for us, since there is no child being born of projection. We're not doing it for any child of ours. We're not doing it for us. We're doing it for nobody. This whole thing is for absolutely no one. Absolutely no one. And this is bound to bring good humor at some point. You know, it's bound to. It's bound to. So. Just letting this sink in, and we gotta go fast before all these induced labor, efforts to induce labor happen. Now some people say, what about HARP and all these kind of, there's a lot of stuff going on to induce labor pains in this world, which I said is to make this story of the past so utterly different than reality that this will automatically trigger the birth of our child. See, so this is kind of inducing labor. And so yeah, there is a lot of weather modification, stuff taking place. All the conspiracy people are in the ballpark about a lot of stuff, okay. But that doesn't solve their ignorance about what the purpose of this world is, which is really, it's again, which I've explained in this video. But there is a lot of efforts to induce labor, which means catastrophes, which means sicknesses, which means problems, which means plagues, which means, you know, famines, droughts, earthquakes, floods, everything. We got this blueprint of how, we have this whole blueprint to bring about this induction of labor, is how we see it, that will cause our child to be finally born. But shall not be any birth whatsoever. And it's for nobody. It's all for nobody. It's for all for naught. All for naught. Much ado about nothing. Therefore, those who know that, you know, stop watching the play. He's not interested in the play. A couple boys are putting on a play. Why do we have to watch it? A couple of the street kids are putting on a play. We really need to stop and watch it, take note, and remember what's going on. That's what Srinath Sargadatta said. He said, what was he living in? He lived in Bombay, right? Bombay, west coast of India. And street kids, you know, just kids that put on a little play. They put on a little play. They get a little monkey there, maybe, and they beg a little money, and they have a little, you know, put a little play on, ridiculous little play, and you're walking along the street. Are you going to stop there and say, okay, I got to pay attention, I got to take note, I got to remember this play, it's so important? Nah, you smile, hi kids, bye, hi kids, and then, okay, bye kids, you know, your credit's good with us kids, and we'll go right along, and that's it. You don't remember it, you don't remember it. And he likened this whole play of the universe to that, just a street kid play. That's it. That's how much importance he gives to it. And that's exactly right. Less, even less importance than that. But he's trying to give an analogy, of course. So it doesn't matter what the street kids are doing, you know, what kind of play the street kids are putting on, right? You know, we don't have to hang around and take notice. We don't have to react to it. We don't have to react to what the street kids play is doing. We don't have to react to it. We don't have to react to it. We don't have to notice it. We don't have to react to it. To take note. Remember. We have to remember it. No reason to remember the past. No reason to consider the future. Not even the present. What's going on? There's no reason to have any reaction to time and space, or anything that's ever happened here. There's no reason whatsoever. We can drop that. We can just drop it. Much ado about absolutely nothing. It's never been for us in the first place. So why do we need to remember it? Right? Unless we want to keep perpetuating it, you know, keep working on it, keep working on it, try to get it ready for our child and trigger the birth of a child, which will never be born. This is ridiculous. So there you go. There you go. Gotta get this up now on YouTube so you all can realize that the Holy Spirit's doing something. Momentum is here. And it's very timely. Very timely. And when stuff happens in the world, you just say, oh yeah, okay. Let's just keep working on this perspective here. And you say, you know what, I do have an explanation for this. I don't have to react to it. I don't have to get caught up in it. Okay. All right. I hope it can sink in some way, and it's not too much for some of you. I understand for some it's too much, but it's important to get this out here, at least to give you pause for thought, food for thought, and just say, you know, if you need to say, okay, it's interesting, very interesting, very interesting, and everything will get better as we go along, for sure. Okay, very great. That's it.